This 100-digit number is the product of two primes. But for 2 weeks in 1991, no one knew which primes they were. The laptop that computed them had been intentionally destroyed, leaving no record of the primes. After an intensive computer search, researchers found these two 50-digit primes, and they fit the bill. Multiply them together, and you get the original number. But are these the same two primes the laptop used to create the number in the first place? How can we be sure when the only record was destroyed? This sounds like a silly question, because every natural number you've ever seen has had only one prime factorization. But why should that be true? What forces the arithmetic to behave so consistently? The answer is far from obvious. In fact, it's surprisingly deep, and it all comes down to some ancient mathematical insight and the world's oldest algorithm. This number was called RSA 100, and it was created by RSA Laboratories as a challenge. See, RSA Laboratories was in the encryption business. Anyone who can factor large numbers like this can break their method of encryption and steal whatever credit card numbers or love letters or classified information was encrypted with it. So to be reasonably confident that no one could, they published several large numbers, each one attached to a cash prize for the first team to factor it. RSA 100 was the smallest of these numbers, and 2 weeks later, it was factored by Manasa and Lenstra, who took home $1,000 for their trouble. If there's only one way to factor RSA 100 as a product of primes, then the primes Manasa and Lenstra found must be the same primes the laptop used. So our goal is to figure out why it is that every natural number has a unique prime factorization. If we start factoring 210, for example, initially there are many ways to break it down. It's 10 times 21, but it's also 2 times 105, and 3 times 70, and 14 times 15, and many others. But if we continue breaking down the factors until we only have primes, then we always get exactly the same result. 2 times 3 times 5 times 7 in some order. Why on earth should that be the case? It's really kind of spooky. The statement that every natural number has a unique prime factorization is called the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. And the ancient Greeks had a proof that it's true. But the proof is quite unusual, because it relies on an algorithm. This was the first algorithm to be described, more than 2,000 years before there was any modern computer to run it on. It appears in Euclid's Elements, and today we call it the Euclidean algorithm. The Euclidean algorithm is at the heart of so much mathematics that the fundamental theorem of arithmetic is just the first of its major applications. To give you a sense of just how powerful it is, let's see two more before we describe it. The second application is a surprising pairing that occurs for each prime number. I'm going to devote a separate video to this pairing, because it's responsible for some really neat results about primes, including Wilson's theorem, which characterizes the primes, Willen's formula for the nth prime, and two entire families of number systems, the integers modulo p and the p-adic numbers. The third application, which we'll start with here, is really basic. How do we simplify a fraction? We give questions like this to middle school students, but we don't teach them the fast way to do it. There's no need to factor the numerator into primes and the denominator into primes. That's really slow. Amazingly, we can compute the greatest common divisor of the numerator and denominator without knowing any of their factors. Let me say that again, because it's the most important fact in elementary number theory. There's a way to compute the GCD of two numbers without factoring them. And that's what the Euclidean algorithm computes, the GCD. Here's the idea hidden inside the Euclidean algorithm. Sorry. If we subtract 143 from 481, the result is 338. Since these three numbers are related by this equation, a common divisor of any two of them is also a divisor of the third, because we can factor it out. In particular, the greatest common divisor of 143 and 481 divides 338. This works the other direction, too. Every common divisor of 143 and 338, including their GCD, is also a divisor of 481. That means the GCD of 143 and 481 is equal to the GCD of 143 and 338. So we've reduced the problem by replacing 481 with 338. And why stop there? If we again subtract the smaller number from the larger number and use the result to replace the larger number like we just did, we'll have reduced the problem further. 338 minus 143 is 195, which replaces 338, and then we can do it again. 195 minus 143 is 52, which replaces 195, and so on. But this is tedious. Is there a better way? Rather than repeatedly subtracting 143, why don't we subtract all copies of 143 in a single step? We can do that by dividing. So here's the Euclidean algorithm. Start by dividing 481 by 143. It goes in 3 times, with remainder 52. We don't care about the quotient 3. That's just how many times we've subtracted 143. So the two numbers we've reduced it to are 143 and 52. Divide again. 143 divided by 52 is 2, with remainder 39. And keep repeating. 52 divided by 39 is 1, with remainder 13. 39 divided by 13 is 3, with remainder 0. And the next step would be to divide 13 by 0. So we better stop there. What did we get? Well, the first GCD is equal to every intermediate GCD, which is equal to the last GCD, which is 13. 13 does actually divide 0, because 13 times 0 is 0. So the GCD is 13. This is how the Euclidean algorithm computes the GCD of two numbers. The last non-zero remainder is the GCD. So how does 143 over 481 simplify? Divide the numerator and denominator by 13, and we get 11 over 37. Great! If we had tried testing small primes instead of running the Euclidean algorithm, we would have made progress quickly. But try that with this example, and let me know which method you prefer. Okay, let's get back to the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. How can we use the Euclidean algorithm to understand why every natural number has a unique prime factorization? On the surface, that would make no sense, because if a proof is going to work for every natural number, there shouldn't be any computation involved. But it turns out that the Euclidean algorithm gives us more than just the GCD. It gives us some extra information, and that's what we'll need to understand why the fundamental theorem of arithmetic is true. You can find this in every textbook on elementary number theory. But the way it's always presented, the Euclidean algorithm comes to the rescue out of nowhere at the last minute. That's really unsatisfying, because you only get the motivation after the fact, and it's not at all clear how you would discover it yourself. So let's forget about the Euclidean algorithm. Let's try to establish the fundamental theorem of arithmetic and just see what we need. Call our natural number n. N has some prime factorization. Because if it's prime, then it has a prime factorization consisting of itself. And if it's not prime and not 1, then by definition it has a divisor that we can use to break it down, and we can continue breaking it down until we only have primes. Why is there only one prime factorization? If I tell you that this number, 158,599, factors into primes like this, and that it also factors into primes like this, how do you know I'm wrong? We see the prime 7 showing up in the first factorization. So if there's only one prime factorization, then 7 must also show up in the second somewhere. And it does show up. It divides 1141. Here's a third factorization. Is 7 also showing up here somewhere? Yeah, it's right here. So why can't 7 just disappear when we break down this number as a times b? Couldn't the contents of 7 somehow get spread out? Maybe a square root of 7 ends up in A, and another square root of 7 ends up in B, and A and B are still integers because each square root of 7 gets multiplied by some other non-integer. I know it feels like this can't happen, but that's your intuition, built up from years of experience working with numbers and never seeing a situation where it does. And your intuition is right, but that's not the reason. We need to show that the contents of 7 can't get spread out, that it's either in one factor or the other. And of course, not just for 7. If p is a prime number, we need to show that if p divides a times b, then p divides a or p divides b. This is called Euclid's lemma. If we can understand why Euclid's lemma is true, then we will have shown the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. So that'll be our goal for the rest of the video. But let's use an example where the numbers are smaller. Suppose p is 7, A is 33, and B is 35. 33 times 35 is 1155. Is 1155 divisible by 7? Well, dividing by 7 gives 165, so yes. Since 7 divides 33 times 35, Euclid's lemma claims that 7 divides 33 or 35. You can probably tell which one it is, but we're trying to understand why Euclid's lemma is true in general, so let's think carefully. If 7 doesn't divide one of these two numbers, why must it divide the other? If 7 doesn't divide 33, we want to conclude that it divides 35. That's equivalent to 35 being a multiple of 7. So a natural way of doing this would be to construct a number k such that 7k equals 35. With particular numbers, this is easy. K is 5. But can we do it in general? Assume that P divides AB and that P doesn't divide A. Can we construct a number k such that PK is B? It's tempting to say, sure, just let K be B over P. But remember, we don't know that B is divisible by P. That's what we're trying to show. In our example, how can we get K in a way that only uses that 1155 is divisible by 7, since that's what we know? Here's the idea, and it's only a little bit clever. Instead of constructing K directly, we'll show that 35 is a multiple of 7 by writing it as a sum of two multiples of 7. Because the sum of two multiples of 7 is also a multiple of 7. The good news is that we already have two multiples of 7 to work with. 1155 is a multiple of 7 by assumption, and of course 7 is a multiple of 7. So if we find some multiple of 1155 and some multiple of 7 that add up to 35, then this will imply that 35 is also a multiple of 7. In other words, that 7 divides 35. What are x and y? Here's one pair of values that works. X equals 3, and y equals negative 490. Both terms on the left side of this equation are divisible by 7, so let's factor out the 7. And you can check that this other factor is indeed 5. Amazing, right? So the last step in understanding why Euclid's lemma is true is to figure out how to find x and y values that work in general. Thinking informally for a second, if we look at this equation, which can be rewritten like this, we can narrow down the possibilities for y. The first and last terms are divisible by 5. So 7y must also be divisible by 5, which means y is divisible by 5. Actually, the first and last terms are divisible by 35. And since we're not assuming that 35 is divisible by 7, then for all we know, y is actually divisible by 35. So let's tentatively write y as 35 times some number z. Now, the question is whether we can find x and z. Well, there's a 35 in all three terms, so if we divide by 35, this simplifies the equation. And if we can find x and z to make this equation work, then it will also make the previous equation work. So can we find x and z? If we look at this equation, any common divisor of 33 and 7 would also divide 1. So for this equation to have a solution, 33 and 7 must have no common divisor greater than 1. In other words, their GCD would have to be 1. This is a really good sign, because this is exactly the assumption we made, that 7 doesn't divide 33. We just need a way to connect 33 and 7 to their GCD, 1. But that's what the Euclidean algorithm does. It computes the GCD, so it'll give us a direct line from 33 and 7 to 1. All we have to do is unravel it. So let's run the Euclidean algorithm to compute the GCD of 33 and 7. 33 divided by 7 leaves remainder 5. 7 divided by 5 leaves remainder 2. Then 5 divided by 2 leaves remainder 1. 2 divided by 1 leaves remainder 0. So we're done. And sure enough, the GCD is 1. Now, by tracking where 33 and 7 end up in each step of the Euclidean algorithm, we'll be able to get a single equation involving 33, 7, and their GCD. And this process is called the extended Euclidean algorithm. When we do this, we have to keep the 33 and 7 intact and resist the temptation to perform arithmetic on them. A good way to do this is to write them as A and P instead, so that we manipulate the variables instead of the numbers they represent. Here's how it goes. This first equation says that a equals 4p plus 5. If we look ahead to the second equation, we see the remainder 5 that came down from the first equation. We're going to want to rewrite this 5 as something involving a and p. So before going there, let's solve for 5 here. Now in the second equation, 5 is a minus 4p, and 7 is p. Let's solve this for 2 so that we'll be able to rewrite 2 in the third equation. Simplifying, we get that 5p minus a equals 2. Now in the third equation, 2 is 5p minus a, and from the first equation, 5 is still a minus 4p. Rearranging and then simplifying, we get that 3a minus 14p equals 1. And that was the goal, a single equation involving a and p and their GCD. Specifically, 3 times 33 minus 14 times 7 equals 1. What does that get us? Well, this equation is exactly of the form 33x plus 7z equals 1. All we have to do is rearrange it. So it gives us one pair of values that works, x equals 3 and z equals negative 14. To get y, we multiply both sides by 35 and use the fact that 33 times 35 is 1155. Since y is 35z, y is negative 490. And now we have what we wanted. 7 divides 1155, so 35 is the sum of two multiples of 7. This implies that 7 divides 35, which is what Euclid's lemma claims. And we never assumed that 7 divides 35. We only used the 7 divides 33 times 35. That's a lot of steps, so here's an example you can try on your own. The same argument establishes Euclid's lemma in general. Assume that the prime p divides a times b. To show that it divides a or b, let's look at the GCD of a and p. Since this GCD is a divisor of p and p is a prime, there are only two possibilities. The GCD is 1 or p. If it's p, then p divides a, and we're done. If it's 1, then the extended Euclidean algorithm guarantees the existence of integers x and z such that ax plus pz equals 1. Multiply by b, and we have b written as a sum of two multiples of p. Then we've got it. P divides b, so we're done. So the proof of Euclid's lemma uses the extended Euclidean algorithm in this totally bizarre way. We need to invoke the extended Euclidean algorithm, but we don't need to actually run it. I love it. Now that we know that Euclid's lemma is true, we know that the fundamental theorem of arithmetic is true. So every natural number has a unique prime factorization. That includes RSA 100. So we know that these two primes are indeed the primes that the laptop used to construct it back in 1991, even though there's no record to check them against. The Euclidean algorithm is such a simple process, but it gives us a huge amount of leverage. It's hard to imagine doing much number theory without it. From simplifying fractions efficiently to establishing unique factorization, it gives us access to divisors of numbers without ever needing to factor. I'm going to make a separate video about this pairing I mentioned that gives us Wilson's theorem, Willen's formula, the p-adic numbers, and the integers mod p. And if you want to see a neat connection between the Euclidean algorithm and the Fibonacci numbers, use the Euclidean algorithm to compute the GCD of 21 and 34, or the GCD of 34 and 55. You're in for a treat.